Hi. So essentially I'm not trying to be a self-help kind of dude or anything like that, but what I am going to do is I'm going to test myself. I'm going to test myself. I'm going to see if I can look that guy in the eye and tell him his life story. I'm not sure what the consequences will be of that. I already know the story, but there was an exercise when I was in drama school where basically you just had to look someone dead in the eye and tell them everything about your day and not look away. Just hold their eye and make sure that they knew that you, that they and you were the only two people in the room. They call it complicity, and it's a complete understanding between me and you, or you and me, or you and whoever you talk to. Eye contact is important when you're trying to tell a story. So I'm going to try and tell my story to myself. Let's see how that goes. All right. Okay, Mike. I was born in 1975, December 30th, the same day as my mother, in a town called Whangarei. Wasn't there for very long before my parents, who had been married. I gotta look, I gotta keep looking. Before my parents, who'd been married for, let's see, I guess 5 years, 4 or 5 years, they'd been trying for a while to have me, their first baby. Before they moved down to a small town called Te Kaweri. God, it's so hard. Keep looking, keep looking. To a small town called Te Kaweri, where, for the first little bit, my mother and my dad, they were both teachers. They'd studied to be teachers. In fact, my mum was still pregnant with me when she first taught at a college here in Auckland, New Zealand. Okay, so anyway, oh, damn, look. Okay, don't look away. Concentrate. Tell yourself the story. Tell yourself the story. Go back to Te Kaweri. Te Kaweri, where my dad delivered vegetables. For the first few years of, for the first year and a half, I think it was, he delivered vegetables nightly on the back of a truck, picking them up from places and then dropping them off at supermarkets. In fact, there was a supermarket there in Te Kaweri called New World, where the chicken was so fresh in this small town of about, I guess it was about 1,200 people or so, where the at that time, anyway, in 1975, which is years ago, 41 years ago. But, man, this is way hard. On, tell the story, you can get through this. Yeah, you can get through this. Do it. Okay, so where was I? The chickens were so fresh that they were actually living out the back of the supermarket, and I remember vividly hearing one of the butchers and seeing one of the butchers go out the back, and I heard a squawk and a bit of chopping, and then the chicken was brought into the supermarket a little bit later. Now, you have to understand, this was a major chain in New Zealand. And New World still is. It's a major chain, so it's not It's not like a corner shop or a country store. It was a major chain that had been picked up by country people. And basically you had fresh live kill happen. Of course, they let the chicken bleed out, but you know that you could order your chicken as you went in and leave, is what I understand anyway. I went to kindergarten there. I can't remember the name of the kindergarten, but I do remember that before we left and when I turned 5, my brother was born in 1978, and he didn't get to go to that kindergarten, but I went to that kindergarten. And I wanted to go to a party one time there. Man, I'm losing track. You've got to stay focused on this. Okay, so yeah, I don't know why I'm tearing up. That's so weird. I'm just telling me my story. Oh, stop it. Don't look. Look in the eye. Come on, you can see this. Pick one eye and look at it. Right. So, there was a costume day. Damn it. You can just turn off then. I'm going to look away because I have to turn this off. Just go. If you have to go, power off. Okay, I'm gonna turn this one off too. Right, start this again. So there was a day in kindergarten, I remember, where there was a bit of a costume day, and I wanted to go as Superman, as any kid did back in those days, as any kid has done for years to any costume party, who's a boy or a girl, doesn't matter, you know, you can be Superman, doesn't really matter what happens there. Man, this thing isn't turning off, and I needed to turn off. I should have done this, sorry guys. There we go. Okay. There we go. I'm getting back to the story. So the story is that I wanted to be Superman. And I had a red pillowcase that I could use as my cape. And I had a blue shirt. But for some reason, I changed my mind at the last moment, and I wanted to go as a little Red Riding Hood. So I did. No one made fun of me. I couldn't be bothered being made fun of, to be honest. And we're all kids, you know? So, well, Little Red Riding Hood was cool. After all, I mean, stay looking. After all, she was a hero. Just like Superman. Anyway, I'm saying anyway, Alan. Got to 5 years old, and we moved from there to a place called Rotorua, which means, Roto means lake, and Rua means two. So essentially there was two there. I spent my first year at primary school there, and it was an experience, that's for sure. My first crush, Alice. My first sort of memories, like full memories. I mean, I've had memories before. When I was in Tekawiti, there was 3 memories there that I remember vividly. One of them being called Spike, because my hair spiked, and my name was Mike, and a Chip's helmet. A Chip's helmet. I remember a Chip's helmet. Why would I remember Chip's helmet? And then I remember a train, a wooden train that my dad had made, and my dad had made a wooden plane. He was into making soft wood toys, that he'd found sort of designs for and cut them out with a saw and glued them together for us. Or he'd never nailed them because he knew that was too dangerous, but he did that for us. So, moving on back to Rotorua. Rotorua, we, There was a new world down the road. Okay, so there was a new world down the road, okay? And this new world was bigger. It didn't have chickens out the back that got killed. But what it did have was a sweets aisle. Now, me and a friend of mine, Hone, or John, as it were, he and I decided that the best idea for us to get sweets was to take them. So we got these, we had this plan, or at least he had a plan, and I'm pretty sure that he knew what was going on. He'd done it before, maybe. But he said, hey, keep a lookout and see if anybody's coming. And he went and took a box of Jaffas. Now, Jaffas are different around the world, but Jaffas in New Zealand are sort of like a snifter. Or, no, not a snifter, I want to say. Basically, it's chocolate wrapped in candy. And a candy shell, a hard candy shell. So we had those. He put them in his pocket and we ran outside. And we found a pile of dirt just slightly down the road. And we sat on that and ate Jaffas. And then I walked home. 5 years old, we were safe enough to walk home. Anyway, I went home. I was a good boy. I cried. I told them. I told my parents. I told my parents that we had stolen. And if I remember correctly, I'm pretty sure that my dad laughed. But then he was very stern with me afterwards. Very stern. Very stern indeed. Keep that eye contact going on. It's funny. It gets easier. I'm not going to look you directly in the camera right yet, but it gets easier as you're going along, because you're getting into the story a bit. Okay, so that's my memory of Rotorua. From there, about a year later, my parents took up other teaching jobs. They moved to Rotorua for teaching jobs, and then they moved to Auckland for a teaching job, and my dad started work at a place called the PPTA, the Post-Primary Teachers Association. And he was heavily involved in education legislation. Ooh, I said that quickly. Education legislation. So, anyway, we lived in a place called Ōtara. Not a very rich area. And we were sort of very middle class. And my memories there are of course, the kids. The kids and the families. There's a few. Mike Royale, R.I.P. He passed away in a horrible accident a few years ago. John Franson, who lived across the road. I've skipped. Yeah, I'll talk about Ōtara first, because that's where most of my memories are. Ōtara. Yeah, John Franson, Alf Bennett, who I still know. I have his phone number on my, right here on my phone that I turned off. Look. That's where I went to primary school, intermediate, and my first year of high school. During that time, it was the 80s. It was mad. Lots of fun, lots of fluoro, lots of sun, lots of BMX accidents, knees grazed, running home at night because it was just a little too late and the sun was coming down. So we'd run home I remember running home with my brother one night and we were crying that we were so scared. But we made it home safely with a bag of hot chips from the Othello fish and chip store. There were some good places there. That's where I started to learn another language, Māori, which is actually my... That's half of me. I'm half Māori, half Irish. So, there we go. I'm not sure I can carry this on. Yeah. There were some memories there. In Pakuranga, that's where we really first moved to. We had our neighbours... Had our neighbour kids there. We had a spy hut in the bushes alongside a river. Basically, where we lived, it was a cul-de-sac, a two-ended cul-de-sac, so the road went up like that and sort of like that. So it was like a T-shape. Why don't I just do a T? It was a T-shape like that. So, yeah, when we lived on... That part of the T for you. We lived on that corner, which backed onto bushy estuary riverside, and we found an old car seat, and we went into a bushwalk there, and we put it to the side, and we set up tarpaulins, and we did our spy stuff there. Lots of memories with cool kids, man, running through the sun, running through the rain, trying to build grass forts and fields. I'm making it sound like it's a real country place, but it's not. It was just that we had grass in grassy fields nearby. When we built grass forts, and I had terrible hay fever, so I was always sick when that happened. Always sneezing, or my eyes were all puffy. And many a memory with fireworks with Elf. Many a memory with my first crush, the neighbor, Alice. Another Alice. Yeah. I can carry on. I could do this. My kids' years were basically a very much boy zone. We played spies, we played cowboys and Indians, we played cops and robbers. We had plastic Uzi guns, water guns, pools, barbecues, ninjas, martial art classes, soccer classes. No, not soccer classes, I'm lying about that. We had martial art classes, we had cricket in the streets, we had rugby in the streets. Very much a Kiwi boy zone. From there, I was 13 when we left. We moved to a place called Whanganui. And that's where I went to school for high school. And let's just say that once I hit 14, my voice dropped. And I became quite popular with the girls, and my high school years were very much a party. School was easy. I didn't bother attending. I didn't need to half the time. The exams were easy. And that's where I first fell in love. In high school, Whanganui, the town with a river running through the middle of it, and a big hill on the side called Jury Hill, where they have a mine shaft elevator, the only kind of it is in the whole world. And you can pay money to walk down a long tunnel and get into this elevator and take a trip to the top. Used to have a ferry there, I'm not too sure if it's still there, a steamboat, that's, yeah, a steamboat. But that's where I first fell in love. I was 14, 15. My parents had broken up. Things had happened, as sometimes they do. I won't get into it, that's their private business, but me and my brother, we dealt with it as best as we could. I found love, he found softball. Pretty much. I found theatre. Started acting. Yeah, we changed between living with our dad to living with our mum, and he lived with dad, and then I lived with mum. They moved out of town. I stayed in town. But her name was Caitlin. And she was. Is. Beautiful. Still remember the days that we had together. Her and her mini, which only had 3 gears. 1, 2, and 3. And, well, I guess 4 if you count reverse, but you don't really need that in a mini. You just sort of push back with your foot like the Flintstones. Strawberry blonde, could do gymnastics. She knew how to do a round off a rebounder. That was the first place that I ever had someone in my life pass away too. Yeah, those were some days. Oh, don't look away. Those were some days. A car crash had happened. People, you know, drunk, I guess. There was, there was a big day when that happened at high school. People were allowed to resit exams because it was in the middle of exams. There was another time further on down the road where that sort of thing happened, but that was the first one. From there, my life has been a series of me lying my way to get into a DJ job at a nightclub after working in radio for 2 years. I worked in radio for 2 years in Whanganui. I'm all over the place, man. I could tell the story in my head to myself, but I can't look at me and tell me my story. I know this video may throw you off. I don't know if you're even watching to this time, but yeah. So that's what happened. Sorry, I just lost in memories right now. I should be telling you them. Radio for, I guess, 2 or 3 years. Then moved to Auckland to be with my mum again, because she moved out of town to go lecture at a university. I then concentrated myself on acting and landed a couple of jobs. Television commercial while I was DJing at a nightclub. That nightclub I lied my way into. Basically, at the interview, I said, "Do you want people to dance? I can make them dance." Then I took one of their jet planes on the table and ate it. And they said, "When can you start?" And I said, "Well, when do you open?" Because it was new. The Loaded Hog. They used to line up for 2 hours to get in that place. It was 2,000 people. Full. And I had Saturday nights to DJ, I think it was. Friday. Friday night. Thursday, Friday night, I had to DJ. Saturday night, I didn't have to, but sometimes I did. And we rocked that place. I rocked that place for 2 years. And met many a woman. Susie. Yeah. My story's seem to come back to girls, don't they? It's a bit of a blur. I can't concentrate on what happened after that time. I took a break and I went to drama school, studied, did my thing, left over the first year because I was bored in the first year. I basically, everything that I'd ever studied before had come up, so I knew where I was. And the director of the school, he told me that too when I auditioned. But I auditioned, my brother had started there but the year before me, because he'd found theatre too and a love for it. During that time in the Hawke's Bay drama school, drinking, so much drinking. And then love. I became a stripper back when I had abs. Love in the sun again. And it's really just been a blur of that. Working in nightclubs and then not working in nightclubs and then being in Wellington and being a stage manager. Wellington is the capital of New Zealand, if you guys are watching still. And then just other things, just many, many things happening over the years. It's all a blur because it was all about drinking. There was a flat where we were proud to have just loads and loads of empty bottles of bourbon. Don't get me wrong, I don't regret doing any of that. I had a lot of fun, met a lot of good people. I still know these people, you know. That's the past now. What's the present, Mike? What are you doing now? What's your thing? You know you've had two kids, and they're both incredible. You don't know them very well, but that's not any fault of anybody's other than yours. Here's the thing, though. You're on YouTube now. A lot of things are going to happen. You don't know what's going to happen, but a lot of things are going to happen in this next year. You're going to meet people. That's what's going to happen to you, Mike. You're going to meet people and you're going to love it. You're a good person. It's going to work out. There's no need to cry. And one day, you'll be able to come back and add to the story and tell it properly. Line it up and it won't be so erratic. Just remember, Mike, love yourself.